We're continuing our study from the Life Change series book called Minor Prophets. This is our second week in this book. So if you haven't already got your copy, go ahead and grab it and bring it with you. Our study picks up in chapter 2, or what they're calling lessons, lesson 2, from the chapters 4 through 7 of the book of Hosea. The prophet in this chapter, our series of chapters, is continuing his case against Israel and the judgments that is being rendered against God's people. We're going to start at the beginning of chapter 4 and read some of the verses in that chapter before we get into the commentary. Hear the word of the Lord, you Israelites, because the Lord has a charge to bring against you who live in the land. There is no faithfulness, no love, no acknowledgement of God in the land. There's only cursing, lying, and murder, stealing, and adultery. They break all off bounds, and bloodshed follows bloodshed. Because of this, the land mourns, and all who live in it will waste away. The beast of the field converts the air, and the fish of the sea are dying. But let no man bring a change, let no man accuse another, for your people are like those who bring charges against a priest. You stumble day and night, and the prophets stumble with you. So I will destroy your mother. My people are destroyed from lack of knowledge. Because you have rejected knowledge, I also reject you as my priest. Because you ignored the law of your God, I will also ignore your children. The more the priests increase, the more they stand against me. They exchange their glory for something disgraceful. They feed on the sins of my people and relish their wickedness. It will be like people, like priests. I will punish both of them for their ways and repay them for their deeds. They will eat but not have enough. They will engage in prostitution but not increase. Because they have deserted the Lord's and give themselves to prostitution, to old wine and new, which take away the understanding of my people. They consult a wooden idol and are answered by a stick of wood. A spirit of prostitution leads them astray, and they are unfaithful to their God. One more verse here. I was about to quit, but we'll get this next one. They sacrifice on the mountaintops and burn offerings in the hills, under oak poplar and terebinth, where the shade is pleasant. Therefore, your daughters turn to prostitution, and your daughters belong to adultery. So, as we're looking at this, we're seeing the continued theme of prostitution in the book of Hosea. Prophet, and as you'll remember from our last study, was asked by God to marry a prostitute, marry a woman of that sort of background, and have children with her, and he did so. And we're seeing this prophecy continue to build on that theme. One of the first things to point out is that the nation of Israel here is who is under accusation. Not looking at an individual group within this country, we're not looking at an individual person, but this is really God has picked the northern kingdom and is levying judgment against all the people, and so the punishment comes to all the people. And we're looking at that from that zoomed out sort of big picture perspective. So it's interesting then, because God zooms back in in verse 7 and starts talking about the priests again, saying, the more the priests increase, the more they sin against me. So I think there's really two kinds of priests that are being talked about here. I don't think it's just the Levites. Remember, the northern kingdom does not have the temple. That's in the southern. That's where the temple properly rests. So the priests are not just the Levites, the people of the tribe of priests, but those priests of idols and of the improper worship of the Lord that is practiced in the northern kingdom. So we're not just talking about failing on the part of that sort of clan, but it's the proliferation of priests of all different types of religions. And we're also looking at the way in which that priesthood was conducted. Remember from our study from last week that I mentioned that ritual prostitution was a main part of the place, took part in that. And what we've read so far of chapter 4 would continue to indicate that the prostitution of the actual human bodies that was going on was equal to and compared to this prostitution of Israel as being unfaithful to God. And the way that the prophet says that in verse 12, yes, 12 in particular, is very interesting. He says, a spirit of prostitution leads them astray. They are unfaithful to their God. There was a spiritual sickness that had gone on. And continuing to verse 13, we saw that the women would be unfaithful. Your daughters-in-law and your daughters will participate in prostitution and adultery. But that wasn't the end. The real punchline for that comes in verse 14. I will not punish your daughters when they commit prostitution, nor your daughters-in-law when they commit adultery, because the men themselves consort with harlots and sacrifice with shrine prostitutes, and people without understanding will come to ruin. Though you commit adultery, O Israel, let not Judah become guilty. Do not go to Gilgal. Do not go up to Beth Aven. I will not swear as surely as the Lord lives. The Israelites are stubborn like a heifer. How then can the Lord pasture them like lambs in a meadow? Ephraim is joined to idols. Leave him alone. Even when their drinks are gone, they continue their prostitution. Their rulers dearly love shameful ways. A whirlwind will sweep them away, and their sacrifices will bring them shame. We see these two places mentioned, Gilgal, which you'll remember is the first place that they camp when they cross the Jordan. Where the Israelites, once they've come into the land fully after the Jordan dries up and Joshua leads them across, Gilgal is the place at which they camp. Beth-Aven is less obvious to us, unless we're looking at our book or making the footnotes of our Bible. This is a play upon Bethel means the house of God. That is another place in the southern kingdom. And it's even now is literally house of idolatry or wickedness. So God is saying, it's no longer my house, right? He's calling it by a new name. So Beth-Aven, the house of idolatry. The accusations that are being leveled here are very severe. And once again, we're seeing, first it was Jezreel, right, in our study from last week. That was going to be a place of shame that turned into a place of honor. I'm sorry, that was going to be a place of honor that turned into a place of shame. But then also he flipped the script on that, where he said the valley of Achor would become a place of blessing. When they get to return to the land, even the cursed place where Achan's sin was punished, that would become a byword for the restoration of the people. So that's how bad their punishment was going. That even past curses from God would seem like blessings. So now we're seeing that again. There's more places being called up in this sort of derogatory, negative way. Verse 19 of chapter 4 as well is interesting in particular, because he says, a whirlwind will sweep them away, and their sacrifices will bring them shame. Baal, one of Baal's common names that we hear a lot is Beelzebub. Okay, that one's a derogatory name that was given by the Old Testament to make fun of God. So he's Lord of Flies. He's just the god of bugs swarming around the poop or a dead body or something like that, right? He's not something to be looked at with honor. The name that the people of the time called him was Beelzebul, which means Lord of the Wind. So God is saying here, the wind is going to sweep them away, because I'm the God of the wind, not Baal. And their sacrifices will bring them shame. So sacrifices which were supposed to glorify either God or their gods will instead turn into a touchstone of their shame instead of a touchstone of glory. And all this priesthood that's been going on is going to be turned into a mockery instead of a moment of glory. In chapter 5, we see some more of this same kind of language. I'm not going to read as much of chapter 5, just to make sure we're using it time wisely, but I'll go ahead and read chapter 5 and verses 4 through 7 here before we continue. Their deeds do not permit them to return to their God. A spirit of prostitution is in their hearts. We see that repeated again. They do not acknowledge the Lord, yet Israel's arrogance testifies against them. The Israelite, even Ephraim, stumble in their sins. Judah also stumbles with them. When they go with their flocks and herds to seek the Lord, they will not find him. He has withdrawn himself from them. They are unfaithful to the Lord. They give birth to illegitimate children. Their new moon festivals will devour them in their fields. So we see again this unfaithfulness bringing about illegitimate children, just like we saw in the earlier chapters. That theme is continuing here. The thing that Hosea was made to act out is now being filled with meaning as the prophecy is continued to be given. If we go to verse 13 of the same chapter here in chapter 5, let's start with 11. We're going to see a couple verses here where God is going to give another part of his prophecy through his prophet that is going to be relevant to our discussion. Ephraim is oppressed, trampled in judgment, intent on pursuing idols. I am like a moth to Ephraim, like a rock to the people of Judah. When Ephraim saw his sickness and Judah his sores, Ephraim turned to Assyria and sent to the great king for help. But he is not able to cure you, not able to heal your sores. For I will be like a lion to Ephraim, like a great lion to Judah. I will tear them to pieces and go away. I will carry them off with no one to rescue them. Then I will go back to my place until they admit their guilt. They will seek my face in their misery. They will earnestly seek me. Continuing to chapter 6, we see, come, let us return to the Lord. He has torn us to pieces, but he will heal us. He has injured us, but he will bind up our wounds. After 2 days, he will revive us, and on the third day, he will restore us, that we may live in his presence. Let us acknowledge the Lord. Let us press on to acknowledge him. As surely as the sun rises, he will appear. He will come to us like the winter rains, like the spring rains that water the earth. So God foretells the returning to him, even as he's telling him about punishment. He says that the people know who God is, so they will seek him. They will try to repent of the sins that they have committed. One of the things that is interesting to me is in chapter 5, we see that God says, don't say, as surely as the Lord lives anymore. Don't use my name as an oath, right? Quit offering these sacrifices to keep my name out of your mouth. You have disrespected me to the last degree, and it's no longer tolerable. And at this point here, where people are talking to each other and saying how they're going to return to the Lord, they say, as surely as the sun rises. So that there's this, as the Lord lives, as surely as the sun rises, like this, you know, surety has now transitioned from swearing by the Lord to sort of making this sort of oath or this statement by something else reliable, which is the sun rising. And that's an interesting sort of shift as God is putting these words out as their future call. Backing up to the beginning of that passage we just read, though, that God calls himself a moth to Ephraim and a rot to the people of Judah. One of the things we saw at the beginning of the passages we've been reading so far today, in chapter 4, was that the more the priests increase, the more they sinned against me, so they will engage in prostitution and not increase. God is saying that he's going to cut off the productivity of the people. He said, you guys are going through the motions of making babies a lot, but I'm going to stop that from being useful to you. The nation is not going to prosper by all these illegitimate children, but instead is going to wither away. God will be like a rot and like a moth eating away at the fabric of the country. He's the one who does the destroying, and he's the one who the people will come to and ask for healing as well. As we continue on, the very end of this chapter, in chapter 6, we see in verse 7, like Adam, they have broken the covenant, and they were unfaithful to me there. One of the things that continues to go on is references to this unfaithfulness, but specifically the mention of Adam is interesting to me because there is some very direct parallels to the garden when we're talking about this sort of destruction being in God's hand and him putting the people out, and then the restoration of bringing people in. Now, for us as Christians, it's filled with even more meaning because if we think of how heaven has been described, it's sort of the new garden. God, Jesus on the cross tells the robber who's next to him that today you will be with me in paradise. Now, paradise is a Persian word borrowed into the Greek language at the time of Alexander's conquest of Persia. And it means a garden, right? It means a glorious garden, preserved, water pumped in and irrigated. It's the most kind of ideal garden you can have. And that is the word that the Greek translation in the Old Testament uses for Eden, the paradise of Eden. And we see it here again in Jesus' time, that you'll be with me in paradise. So he's saying you're going to be with me in Eden. So heaven is sort of this restoration of God's presence with, and so this sin of being leaving God, we talked about last time, the restoration will only finally come when the Messiah, who is prophet, priest, and king, Jesus, comes. So we're looking at that again here. In chapter 7, we see more of, at the very beginning, more shame being brought on these people. God specifically says that the people delight in their wickedness. He compares the country to a man who has become, he just continues to use this word Ephraim, the sort of poetic name for this nation, and he compares it to a man who has become so engrossed in this adultery that he doesn't realize what's happening. Verse 4, they are all adulterers, burning like an oven, whose fire the baker need not stir from the kneading of the dough till it rises. On the day of the festival of Arcane, the princes became inflamed with wine, and he joins hands with the mockers. Their hearts are like an oven, they approach him with intrigue. Their passion smolders all night, and the morning blazes like a flaming fire. All of them are hot as an oven, they devour their rulers, all their kings fall, and none of them calls on me. Ephraim mixes with the nations. Ephraim is a flat cake not turned over. Foreigners sap his strength, but he does not realize it. His hair is sprinkled with gray, but he does not notice. Israel's arrogance testifies against him, but despite all this, he does not return to the Lord his God or search for him. And we get some more of that comparison throughout the rest of this chapter as well. But specifically, it's interesting because you'll remember from the previous chapters, it's the prostitution, and immediately after mentions raisin cakes. Okay. And then, like, oh, they loved the raisin cakes. Well, that was part of the Baal worship for this thing. I know for us now that wouldn't be terribly decadent to do raisin cake, but that was pretty much the height of luxury to have something sweet with raisins at that time. So we're looking at these guys who are being compared now not only to the people who partake in them, but almost like the act of doing every single thing that you can do for prostitution, from making the food that's eaten in adultery, all the way down to the sexual acts themselves, are being compared directly to what the actions of Israel is taking. One more passage I want to make sure we look at this morning before we continue our discussions on Wednesday was starting in verse 13 of chapter 7. Woe to them, for they have strayed from me, destruction to them, because they rebelled against me. I long to redeem them, but they speak lies against me. Right there, that verse alone is preached. I long to redeem them, but they speak lies against me. They do not cry out to me from their hearts, but wail upon their beds. They gather but for grain and new wine, but turn away from me. I trained them and strengthened them, but they fought evil against me. They do not turn to the Most High. They are like a faulty bow. Their leaders will fall by the sword because of their insolent words, and for they will be ridiculed. For this they will be ridiculed in the land of Egypt. So even Egypt, which was shamed by the Israelites escaping, is going to mock them when the Lord turns, right? And 7 verse 16 also reminds me of chapter 1 verse 5, where it said that of Israel that the Lord will break Israel's bow in the valley of Jezreel. We talked about that. Israel's bow was the representation of their military might. So God's bringing that imagery up again. They do not turn to the Most High. They are like a faulty bow. They're insufficient weapons for the task for the foe that they are trying to fight. Is there anything I missed before we continue on today? One thing I think I'll just reiterate as we're closing here. In chapter 6 and the verse 1 and 2 and 3, those three verses are really about this refreshing, returning to the Lord and being healed. But specifically, it mentions that the Lord will revive us, restore us on the third day. So that's there, verse 2. And God will be to us like winter rains and like spring rains. The commenters in the book say that, in their view, that this does not directly point to Jesus' resurrection, but instead is just looking for a picture of renewal. Based on the wording where it says, "will restore, revive us on 2 days and restore us on the third," I can see where they're going for that. There definitely is a little bit of Christology in this book. We've seen that up to this point, and I don't think that this is totally devoid of pointing towards Jesus. I don't think it's fair to say this was fulfilled by Jesus. I don't think this is a prophecy of his resurrection necessarily, but it definitely points forward to what we have to look forward to in the resurrection as Christians. We can look at God as one who heals our wounds, one who restores us. And you know, the idea of the winter rains and spring rains, the water, the earth, that renewing of life after the winter, after everything looks dead, that the leaves come back out and the flowers begin to blossom and all those sorts of things that I'm sure we're all about ready to see happening anytime. It's cold enough for me, but we'll take our seasons as we get them, because the Lord made those too. So, that's all I have to talk about from our chapter 2 lessons for today. If you want to be prepared for Wednesday, please do take some time and answer those questions the best you can for our discussion, as many as you have answers for. We'll make sure to make time to talk about them on Wednesday.